speaker needs no introduction, but I'm going to introduce her anyway. Marcela García, Munich, PhD, 2008. She holds appointments both at UNAM and at the Universidad Michoacana de San Nicolás de Hidalgo, which is 3 hours away, so she has a crazy commuting situation. She's the author of very many articles on Schelling, Aristotle, and contemporary metaphysics, and the project that she's working on currently is on Energeia and German idealism. And there's a handout, so make sure you have it.
Well, thank you very much, and thank you, Chelsea. It was actually really nice now because I did see really interesting things that I wanted to ask you about, but I will do it later. And what I did in relation to the last NAS is concentrate on, not take away the last NAS I talked about, Entelecheia and Energeia. And I really like what you said about Energeia as now, and the difference between Entelecheia and Eshin, I think was a very important distinction for Schelling. But what I'm doing here, or what I want to do here, is concentrate on what Schelling takes from that interpretation of Aristotle to his, for his own systematical structure of the late system, and put it in connection with some of the recent discussions of the late system. So in this paper, I address a problem of Schelling's late philosophy, the relation between negative and positive philosophy, and the role of the pure Das in the transition from one to the other. While the so-called transition is a well-known and much-discussed issue, recent scholarship has underlined the difficulties involved in the mere notion of pure Das. I propose that we can avoid some of these difficulties by taking into account Schelling's particular and original interpretation of Aristotle's notion of sexuality, energeia, and the way he applies this notion in his late negative philosophy. I would like to begin by stating a philosophical problem of which the late Schelling becomes aware, and which will provide the context for his reading of Aristotle. As you know, the late Schelling considers most of modern philosophy, including his own earlier work, to be a merely logical philosophy that ignores existence. In order to express this deficiency, he takes up Leibniz's question, why is there something? Why not nothing? It seems that there is no necessity of thought that can give an answer to this question. We cannot explain the fact that something exists at all. Actuality, Wirklichkeit, the actual existence of the world, cannot be explained by thought. Besides, whenever we try to think of what is actual, we cannot avoid turning it into a content of thought, that is, into a mere possible. Pure thought cannot grasp actuality as such. But what is it that we lack then? If the actuality of the actual does not consist in an intelligible content, as it's not a real predicate in Kant's words, how can we even express actuality through concepts? Can we think actuality at all? Schelling's interpretation. Schelling's interpretation of Aristotle takes place in the context of his late philosophy into a negative and a positive philosophy, while negative philosophy is a purely rational, a prioristic development of the necessary contents of reason. Positive philosophy realizes that this logical necessity only refers to the connections between the contents and not to their existence, which remains contingent. Positive philosophy is the a posteriori understanding that seeks to make sense of historical contingent existence and can deal with freedom and personality. The main motivation that leads Schelling to work on a negative philosophy in his very last years is precisely the attempt to show from within negative or purely rational philosophy itself that the mere contents or determinations are insufficient because they can only exist if there is something actual that brings them into existence. So the problem that, one of the problems that Schelling's late philosophy has that he aims to solve with the use of the Aristotelian notion of actuality is the following: the relation between negative and positive philosophy and the role of the so-called pure Das in the transition from one to the other. While this transition is a well-known and much discussed issue, even already among Schelling's contemporaries, recent Schelling scholarship has underlined some difficulties involved in the mere notion of pure Das. And briefly, this problem of the pure Das has three different aspects. The first would be how to understand the relation between negative and positive philosophy, avoiding both a leap and a mere continuation. This is a problem that Schelling himself aims to solve in his very last years. He's very preoccupied with this problem. We might call it the Jacobi problem, in the sense that Jacobi criticized modern philosophy for being an abstract philosophy with no room for immediacy, existence, personality. But he thought that faith was the alternative, the salto mortale. And Schelling agrees with Jacobi's criticism of modern philosophy, but he thinks the solution lies in a different way of doing philosophy, of exercising reason, which can adequately deal with aspects such as existence and personality. So how to avoid both the leap and the mere continuation, first problem. Second, why does Schelling go back to developing a negative or purely rational philosophy in his last years? Michel Koch has called attention to the problem of the exact relation between the contents of the positive and the negative philosophy. While negative philosophy is supposed to deal with necessary contents of thought, positive philosophy is to deal with actuality. And the following dilemma emerges. Either the contents of negative philosophy are what positive philosophy will regard as existence, as existent, but then negative philosophy would indeed grasp existence, albeit partially, and positive philosophy would only confirm necessities of thought, or necessities of thought play no role in actuality, but then Schelling would destroy the notion itself of necessity. And this is the problem of a coexistence of negative and positive philosophy, if you will, stressed by the fact that Schelling does not abandon negative philosophy, but indeed dedicates his very last years to its revision. And the third problem is the notion of pure das contradictory. Edward Beach has shown that the asymmetry between was and das is problematic. How can the das, the quod, be independent from the was, the quid? If a pure das is a contradiction in terms, how could positive philosophy start out from this? Quoting Beach, the real difficulty lies in the undertaking to conceive in some manner of a reality which supposedly would transcend conceptualization altogether. How to conceive that which cannot be conceived? I suggest that we can avoid some of these difficulties when we pay closer attention to the way Schelling interprets Aristotle's Energeia and applies it in his last work. So second part, Schelling's interpretation of Aristotelian Energeia. There is in particular one issue, and this is just a very short reference to this Energeia and Telegeia distinction that I mentioned. There's one issue that is relevant to Schelling's interpretation of Aristotle, and is very much discussed within Aristotelian scholarship. The term energeia itself is problematic. It can be understood in a general sense as the opposite of potentiality, of dynamis, in which case it would be translated as actuality or actualization, either one. In this general sense, energeia can be used interchangeably with entelecheia. However, there are other Aristotelian passages where energeia, in a stricter sense, is contrasted with movement or change, kinesis, in which case it would be best translated as activity. This is not simply a difficulty of translation, but one of understanding. Indeed, the philosophical question would be precisely how these different aspects, being in actuality as opposed to potentiality on the one hand, and an activity that does not involve movement or change on the other, can come together under one term. That is how they are related to each other, philosophically. I think Schelling sees in Aristotle's metaphysics a progression from actuality as an actualization of something potential towards an actuality that is not the actualization of anything. And how can we think of such an actuality? Only if we see it as activity in a strict sense, that is, as an energeia that is not movement and does not imply any process. For this reason, Schelling distinguishes sharply between entelecheia as actualization of and energeia as activity. Schelling also underlines that for Aristotle, actuality does not merely refer to the instantiation of certain intelligible contents, but to an individual and active principle that brings such potential contents into existence. Contents of thought are universal, not individual, and in themselves merely possible, not actual. For this reason, Schelling understands the search for an individual actuality in Aristotelian metaphysics as a search that points beyond intelligible contents, because contents in themselves are not individual and not actual. Individual actuality appears in Aristotelian metaphysics in stages, according to Schelling. In each of these stages, the principle that brings potential universal contents into existence is individual and actual. However, Schelling is using individual in a particular sense. not as the instance of a general term or as something particular that happens to fall under a general concept, since this sense of individual would consider something only from the point of view of the contents it instantiates, from the point of view of what it is. Rather, Schelling understands individuality here as self-being, self-sein. Schelling applies this term to different stages of Aristotelian naturality. So very briefly, these are the four stages. You have a substance, usia, what is in virtue of itself, what is selbstseiend, in contrast to mere attributes. And you can see this in quote 3 on your handout. I will quote Schelling. But for him, Aristotle, eidos is act, that is, not a mere quid, not a mere vas, but rather the das, the quo, of the quid, posited in the being, the same as the usia, insofar as this is cause of being for the corresponding being, in our expression, that which is the being. The second stage would be the essence, tienainai, understood as the form and actually as the soul of living beings. Schelling writes that this is what constitutes something's self. For animate beings, it is their soul, since it is what actually is each of them. In other words, the soul constitutes the living being's self, but this means that the soul is not its own self. The soul both actualizes a body that has life potentially and instantiates a general concept. It is the das of the vas, but not its own vas. This is quote 4. As energeia, the soul is the quo, das, of this determined body, but not a das which is separable from it. In this respect, the vas is contained and conceived in the das vas in the das. Only in this sense is an eidos also the concept. The third step would be nous, the intellect. Schelling follows Aristotle in the characterization of nous as having the nature of pure actuality. The nous is neither derived from other parts of the soul, nor does it require a material substrate. In this sense, nous is independent and separable from matter and from movement. It is not bound to any preconditions and can be understood as radically new. Quote 5. Something new because it has nothing of which it would follow necessarily, so if it is, it is purely out of itself, and therefore also only itself. That is, it contains nothing universal, but rather, where it is only for itself and individual, as God is individual. And then the fourth stage, the fourth step of actuality would be God, as that whose substance itself is energeia, hu heusia energeia. Schelling refers to the Aristotelian God with the term absolute individual, absolutus einzelwesen. While the soul is not its self, it actualizes and instantiates material contents, the pure actuality is God considered, as Schelling writes, in his pure self, seinem reinen Selbst nach. You can see quote number 6 on the handout. In other words, instead of being das of a vas, it is pure das. Quote 7, an absolutely individual being, which as such is pure actuality without mixture, that excludes all potentiality, not entelecheia, but energeia. What can he mean with the expression pure das? Since Schelling repeats elsewhere that nothing could exist without being something, see quote 8 from the Quelle der ewigen Wahrheiten essay, it would seem that he is speaking here of a way of considering existence. Quote 9. So to consider something not from the perspective of the contents it happens to instantiate, of what it is, but simply from the point of view that it exists. This perspective would take the individual being into account as if it were independent of, separable, prior to, those contents. This is quote 10. Of him as he is in himself, in his pure self, one cannot say what he is, but only that he is, nur das ist. This is that being which is independent and separable from all what, towards which science strives. So I suggest that the pure actuality is the anticipation of a way of considering existence, a way of pointing at something that cannot be reached through the purely rational means, the perspective on an individual considered from the point of view that it exists. Thus, beyond the contents, vas, it might instantiate. The pure actuality is here, as Schelling says, a negative concept, see quote 11. Indeed, in the case of the pure actuality, there is nothing to determine. It is rather a pure positing of existence without a concept that accounts for it. And I will read now quote 12, Schelling. And well, as Kant says, all existential judgment is synthetic, that is, a judgment in which I go beyond the concept. This is not in any way applied to the pure das, liberated from anything universal, as it remains standing at the end of rational science, because the pure abstract das is not a synthetic judgment. So this is the role of the pure das within the purely rational philosophy is that of a negative notion, a negative concept. Why? Because at each step of the purely rational philosophy, actuality turns out to be beyond the contents that have been grasped. It points towards something that it cannot reach with this purely rational approach. Thus, through this notion, reason touches the limitations of purely rational philosophy and its paradox nature. It tries to think a neutrality that it can never know. Only after this realization of its limits can we speak of the purely rational philosophy as a negative philosophy. Is having a negative concept tantamount to having nothing at all? Has Schelling simply negated all thinkable contents? And that's the end of the story. I think we should rather think of a negative concept as a silhouette that has been carved out by eliminating all that is not actual and individual in the sense sought after. This negative concept, or inverted idea, ultimately leads to a crisis where rational procedure experiences its own limitation and the need for a new method becomes clear. The individual who has been enclosed up to this point in purely rational philosophy realizes that she has a practical existence in the world and that action is inevitable. She decides to abandon the negative method and search for a practical principle capable of action in the world. This decision precipitates a crisis of rational philosophy and leads to its abandonment. This would be quote 13. However, Schelling seems to use the term pure das for two moments in the transition from negative to positive philosophy, both for the notion at the end of purely rational philosophy, a negative concept, a pointing at something beyond contents, and for the starting point of positive philosophy, the standpoint of existence from which positive thought can begin. Once the pure actuality has been expelled from the idea and rational philosophy itself has been abandoned. So this second pure das that you can see on quote 14 seems to refer to the ecstatic state of a reason that is now turned inside out. And this is the quote that I will read, is quote 15. That which just is, das bloß sein, is being, das sein, from which, properly speaking, every idea, that is, every potency, is excluded. We will thus only be able to call it the inverted idea, the umgekehrte Idee, the idea in which reason is posited outside itself, außer sich gesetzt. Reason can posit being in which there is still nothing of a concept, of a whatness, only as something that is absolutely outside itself, als ein absolutes außer sich setzen. Of course, only in order to acquire it thereafter, a posteriori, as its content, and in this way to return to itself at the same time. In this positing, setzen, reason is therefore posited, gesetzt, outside itself, absolutely ecstatic. So once reason has become inverted, it can only posit the existent, devoid of contents, as an absolute outside of reason, where the term outside is capitalized, rather than the term absolute. So it is an outside of reason. Als ein absolutes außer sich setzen. In so doing, reason is beside itself or outside itself, außer sich, and itself positive, außer sich gesetzt. After the crisis, we have then a pure das in a different sense, not as a negative notion beyond reach, but as a realization of our own facticity, as assuming of our own contingency, our existence, in a practical sense, previous to any conceptualization. So at the turning point, the crisis, reason has posited itself as existent. This means that if positive philosophy has to begin from a different standpoint, and this standpoint of existence that is beyond contents, this does not mean that I have to somehow step outside of reason or thought, but rather to realize that reason and thought are always already taking place within the larger framework of actual existence. Reason, thought, are themselves existent. The rejection of negative philosophy takes place from a standpoint of existence. Rather than going over into existence, negative philosophy realizes that it is situated, posited, within a historical practical framework, the standpoint of existence which was always already there. To give an account of this larger framework, purely rational thought is not enough, and we must find a new way of interpreting reality. In order to adopt this new standpoint of existence, we have to have this experience of the insufficiency of contents of thought. And so the question for Schelling is how the negative philosophy itself can lead to the realization of the insufficiency of these contents regarding the standpoint of existence. What the rational philosophy strives for through pure actuality, that is, the standpoint of existence, grasping oneself as a particular existent, can only ultimately be attained by the willing self or I. Only through a humiliation of reason, as Schelling says, quoting Kant, can a different approach to actual reality begin. One that starts out from actual existence and then attempts to make sense of it a posteriori. Whatever determinations or capacities are regained after starting out from the pure dust as standpoint of particular existence, these contents gained a posteriori will have a different status than those of purely rational philosophy. So now to conclude, taking into account the way Schelling interprets Aristotelian actuality allows us to avoid three aspects of the problem of the pure das and of the relation between negative and positive philosophy. First, the problem of the irrational leap. The search for actuality in Aristotle shows, step by step, the insufficiency of contents to adequately deal with the individual and active principle that puts them into existence. Aristotle is useful in order to articulate what is missing from a negative philosophy so that it can reach that critical point where its limitation becomes evident. By proposing a transition that is not irrational but is carried out by negative philosophy as it progressively realizes its own limitation, we can avoid the irrational salto mortale. And this is precisely the function of this last negative philosophy. Second, the problem of the relation between contents and actuality. Negative and positive philosophy have different realms. Negative philosophy constructs a formal structure of possibility, but it cannot adopt an existential standpoint. The problem that advances the development of the late negative philosophy is not whether things exist, but rather to understand what actuality itself is. Schelling concludes that the only way to think actuality is by grasping our own actuality, not a mere instantiation of contents, but dealing with our own individual contingent existence, which inevitably compels us to act. Positive philosophy that starts out from this standpoint will develop concepts that are oriented towards interpreting a historical actuality in which we must act. In this sense, it does not destroy the contents reached by negative philosophy, but it does limit negative philosophy to its realm. Purely rational philosophy is not considered absolute philosophy anymore. And third, the problem of a contradictory pure das. Taking Aristotelian actuality into account explains why the pure das, as pure individual actuality, functions in purely rational philosophy as a negative notion. That is, it points towards a way of considering individuality that the negative method cannot fully grasp. The negative pure das points to something that can only be grasped from a different standpoint, the perspective in which I grasp myself in an existential sense as individual that cannot avoid action. This standpoint is pure das in a positive sense, as the horizon for a philosophy whose concepts will be formed from that starting point. Thank you very much.
So much for your talk. I saw a lot of some of the ideas that I talked about yesterday.
Thanks for your talk. So I was hoping you could maybe say a word or two about how the ecstasy that you just spoke of is connected with also the ecstasy in the early lectures. And what I'm really curious about is how reason that's posited outside itself, what is the outside itself signifying? Because one can very kind of, one can confuse that reason outside itself could somehow engender a kind of irrationalism.
It somehow
could engender a kind of irrationalism.
Oh.
So I'm hoping that you can say more about how reason going outside itself doesn't result in that. You can say that more words are about. And can I ask one more question? Okay. So I also had a question about Schelling's distinction between Aristotelian and Energeia. One way that I think about Aristotelian, and this is from Edward Hopper's One in Many and Aristotle's Metaphysics, is that Aristotelian is a kind of activity that has its end within itself. So that the activity, the means by which the end is achieved, is the same thing as the end itself. So this is in life and intellect, right? So the pure intellect of God could be read as a kind of entelechia, right? Where the thinking is the means and the end itself. So what I'm wondering is, this is why I'm asking, is it's not clear to me that actually there's a clear distinction between energeia and entelechia in thought thinking itself. There's no say this. So I'm hoping that you could say, I'm wondering whether the Schelling gets Aristotle right, or if there's something that would be problematic in his reading, and whether that affects the career calendar. Thanks a lot.
Okay, thank you for both questions. So, first, to the first point, what does outside reason mean? The way I read this is that it is a sort of a change between the space of reason, or the space of the logical space that Arturo mentioned, that we discussed with Arturo, to a space that is constituted by confrontation, to use Thomas Mohan's term. So kind of an interpersonal space that becomes available to the positive standpoint, but not to the negative standpoint. So outside itself, or posited outside itself, I don't think means moving outside of reason, or suddenly leaving itself, or being in irrationality or something like that, but realizing that reason itself exists, right? So this is something that also Marcus Gabriel has underlined, that has used as an inspiration from Schelling. No? So reason, thought, are in themselves existent. And I think this is something that Schelling clearly says, and this is one of the passages, I think, where he's trying to say that. So that it is more the realization that reason does not exist in a void, or it's not itself the container of existence, but rather the other way around. So reason is existent. There is something, a larger framework, right, within which reason happens. Yeah? And it has to do with that question, why is reason, why does reason exist, that he asks in philosophical empiricism. You know, why is there not irrationality? So, and how that's connected to Erlangen, I cannot answer at this moment, but I'm happy to discuss that with you. And whether this is a correct reading of Aristotle, I think he has a point. There's a discussion in Aristotle of whether, what does God, the pure actuality, think? And there's this problem, no? If it thinks things that are inferior, then it's being determined by those things, so actually it can only think itself. And there's different ways to read that, no? So there's a possible reading that doesn't focus on the contents of that thought, because it would mean having some sort of potentiality through those forms that it's thinking, but rather to focus on the thinking, right? Just the activity itself. And I think Schelling has a point in focusing on that. And he thinks, the reason why he's underlining this is because he thinks Hegel mixed those two, or didn't distinguish them enough. So Hegel was translating entelechia as concept, and you know, he wasn't really distinguishing between the content and the activity, which is, of course, what Hegel, for his own reasons, wants to do. But I don't think you have to read Aristotle that way, but I think you can, and Well, I was happy to be here that Chelsea had some arguments, I think, that could go in that direction as well. You know, if Energeia can have a stricter sense that is not involved in actualization of, then there is like a stricter sense of Energeia where it's just the activity. And you're not thinking about whatever is potential and is becoming actualized.
Thank you for your paper, it was wonderful. I especially like this negative gas at the end, becoming positive gas at the beginning of the philosophy of philosophy. I have a little question about the point you made. You said that at the beginning, you said that Schelling is constructing a purely rational philosophy just to demonstrate its limits. But he sort of does it way too many times in order for that to just be what he's doing. I think there's more to it. I wonder what you could say to that. Thank you.
Okay, so if I understand your question correctly, you're saying, are you referring to the other versions of negative philosophy? Okay. Even just the purely rational philosophy itself is such a comprehensive undertaking.
Yes.
Yes, okay. And he's integrating natural philosophy in its late version.
Yes.
In it. Doesn't have to be... Okay, here's a way to answer that. It's not just negative philosophy. There's a certain point in the text where it becomes clear that it's negative philosophy. It doesn't start out as negative philosophy. And that's the whole point, is that the limitation becomes evident as it progresses. But it starts out as a legitimate attempt of having a purely rational philosophy. And I think Schelling thinks you have to, this is part of the nature of reason, is you have to attempt to develop this kind of philosophy. So it's not, and he's not completely saying, okay, now that I've done this, please no one engage in this. So it's no, it's reason does this. This is what reason has to go through. So it's not that he's only doing it with obstructive intention. But I think he's very interested in how do I construct a purely rational philosophy so that it will also show itself to be negative. And that's a work of art that he is trying to develop. Yeah.
Thank you, Marcela. Thank you very much. I'm following almost every point. I've got a question to text 15. How do you understand it?
Which number?
Text 15.
Okay.
In that moment, when there is the colorless idea, the reason for the sitting in which there is still not that concept of what has done is something that is absolutely outside of itself. Of course, only in order to acquire it, thereafter, any posteriority has its content. And in this way, you return to itself at the same time. And my question is how to understand this acquiring thereafter. As the content. Is that the context in which the sentence of Schelling is to be placed that we have to drop the concept of God? You can't say that what you call it thereafter the term around is the content God you thereafter, the negative philosophy or something like that, that you have to drop. And then it's only the being compulsory is a computation.
Thank you. Yeah, I think that you're right to point to exactly that point, that passage. It would seem problematic. It would seem like he was holding on to something. If he's able to even say, we're going to regain the content, we're going to regain this Zion there without idea, this completely free of content, is going to be regained as a content later. isn't he trying to save already too much from this negative pure das, right? You might also think it's just this, you're at a new standpoint of existence, and whatever fills up the new standpoint, I mean, whatever comes up within this space, the confrontational space, but it wouldn't have to be necessarily the notion of God. No. You could also read it that way. It's completely open, and we'll see what turns up. Yes, but I agree that it's not very, yeah. I think I would like to understand it that way as well, but I'm not sure the text allows us to go.
Thank you for your willingness to come. I was just wondering, how much would you agree with the following sort of interpretation? This Schelling sees himself as completing the Kantian project. Sees himself as helping to complete is too small, bringing forward, you know, the building of a cathedral. How much can we graft, or how much can we see Kant trying to draw the limits of pure reason and see Schelling drawing the limits of pure reason, calling it negative philosophy, and then trying to create the transition to a practical philosophy in a much broader way that allows him to situate what he's aiming at in his positive philosophy, which is a philosophical religion, so that once he draws the limits of pure reason, he can then talk about religion beyond those limits. And when it's beyond those limits, it's not mutually exclusive, it's not a rejection, it's not a movement into irrationalism. The simplistic way that I always try to explain this is, negative philosophy, you're in the library, you leave the library at some point, right? And you leave the library, and it doesn't mean you've forgotten anything that you've done there, it doesn't mean you no longer think the way that you thought in the library, but you're in the world. It becomes time to actually do what you're doing, trying to discover and create the content that's seeking to be received. But I'm just curious about your thoughts in terms of seeing the relationship between negative philosophy and positive philosophy as an improvement upon the way that Kant was trying to do the same. Because Kant was trying to create the space for faith by drawing a clear the limits of pure reason.
Yes, thank you. Thank you for that question. Well, I think he's trying to do that, and he's trying to be more radical than Kant. You know, he thinks Kant stays halfway through the process, or he continues having too many ideas that are helpful to think, that we have to think, like the ens realissimum and that kind of, we need to have those thoughts, but only as ideas, right? That's also the way reason operates. We don't know if that exists, we're not able to say anything about the existence of something like that, but those ideas are there. And I think Schelling wants to go farther and wants to show how those ideas like that do not hold their own. They're not, they kind of are deconstructed by Schelling in a way. And in that sense, he thinks he's completing the project and he's radicalizing the project. He might go too far though, in a way, no? And this goes in relation with Diana's question. So if the purely rational philosophy ended up being just a negative philosophy and it had just the goal of distracting reason or humiliating reason, then you would have the problem that Michel Koch had talked about, no? This destroying necessity. So what happens to the contents that we reached in negative philosophy once we've gone through the crisis, once we leave the library, are the books still there? Or do we burn it down? You know, kind of thing. So I think we have to be careful when he himself speaks in this hyperbolic way to see what that he maybe isn't that radical. I mean, he's radical, he wants to be more radical than Kant, but he still has a space for something like pure reason. So, yes.
Well, thank you very much. Very inspiring, actually. What I I'm very convinced the first two points, but not the suspicion of the glitter, the pure outside. And I was wondering if the outside has to be pure, because it seems to me that here runs into a paradox, and the paradox is the right answer. It's not what I have to move away from, but maybe the paradox is precisely the answer, and I will tell you why. When you say, you formulate these terms, it's about thinking the unthinkable. So it seems very much like Russell's paradox. You think the unthinkable. Is it a thought, or is it not a thought? It's not a thought, but it refers to the unthinkable, but it's also a thought. So it would be a thought and not a thought at the same time. So maybe it's not about finding pure outside, but something is inside and outside at the same time. That the dust is on the one hand pure dust, but also a dust without being purely absorbed in the dust. In other words, I would say, I'll put it this way, the limits of reason also generate a discourse on all the reasons of the limits, so to speak. So in a way, to put it more concretely, what would you say about the role of paradox in grounding or in explaining the relationship between negative and positive philosophy? That maybe it's not a problem, it's not about thinking pure outside or non-rational, but rather paradoxical relationship between the positive and the negative. So thinking in a way, the paradox relationship would be the grounding.
So I like this, the limits of reason generate other reasons. So I agree with that, because it seems, one, from the standpoint of the beginning of the purely rational philosophy, it seems the only way to do philosophy is purely rationally. And by the time we're at the crisis, we realize, why reason is more than that, so to speak. Or there's other ways of applying rationality. There's other versions. There's other versions of rationality. So I like the way you formulate that. I'm not quite sure whether it's the paradox itself that would be the generation. That sounds too Hegelian to me, in a way. Wait, because it would seem, one way to understand that would be, oh, so Schelling is sitting there trying to think the unthinkable or conceive the unconceivable, and then, boom, positive philosophy. And that is too much like a leap. So there must be some other way of doing the process that doesn't go too fast, in a way, that doesn't take you to the end too fast, that allows you, and maybe this also has to do with Diana's question, that allows you to develop all the steps, including the potencies and the nature philosophy and the political philosophy and all that is included in the purely rational philosophy before it crumbles, kind of speak, right? So that maybe the search for actuality is constructed in a very careful way so that it will end up in a paradox but doesn't begin with a paradox. Something like that.
Okay. Well, we're not at the end of the queue, but we're at the top. So, last time.